Hello, my name is Ben Brownlee for Boris FX, and we're going to be taking a look at Continuum's Depth Map ML filter now, both as a standalone effect and also how we use it inside of Pixel Chooser. Depth Map ML is another one of Continuum's AI-powered filters, and you'll find it both under the key and blend as a standalone effect. But if we look at any of the BCC plus effects, for example, something like smoke and fog, you'll also find it under the mocha mask and track inside of Pixel Chooser in its own section. Now, in terms of main functionality, these two are both the same. So if you load it one place, you can use it in the other place. But the standalone version has a few little bells and whistles, which we'll take a look at a little bit later. I'm going to start in the Pixel Chooser version. And so we can see what we're doing, I'm going to turn on View Map Mask and now enable Depth Map ML. So as soon as I turn this on, it's going to use its AI-powered model to try to decide what is going to be in the foreground, what's going to be in the background. And in Pixel Chooser, it represents this as a black and white image, white being in the foreground, black being in the background. Now, in terms of us getting this looking right for us, we have three things we need to think about. Firstly, is the overall mapping. So what counts as the furthest bit in the background? What counts as the closest bit in the foreground? And here we look at the mapping modes, and let's take a look at this on a different piece of footage. Okay, so we're in Premiere Pro now, and here's the shot that we're going to be looking at. We just have some cars and trucks coming down the road and leaving frame. All right, and let's take a look now at the Depth Map ML version of this. And if we look at a still frame, this looked pretty good. We can see the road going off into the distance. We can see the cars, the trees, all of that sort of fun stuff. But let's just play this back at default settings and see what the problem is. So we can see now that as we play this through, when the cars come down and break the wall there, it sort of looks as if everything kind of dips down or dims down. Almost like we've got a camera on auto exposure. And so we get that sort of flashing going on. And the reason for that is that we currently have our mapping mode set to min max. So this is automatically recalibrating the gradient that we have between whatever is the current far point and the current nearest point. So if we look at this frame now, we can see the thing that is closest to us is probably the front of the road. So that is going to be the white. And the back, we just have like random whatever there is in the background, nothing much in the background. But if we come in and just wait a few more frames, this takes on the closest point, the nearest point. And because the background is still the same, everything else kind of adjusts in between it. We're going to have a look at the mapping mode. We can go to scale, manually add a little scaling in here, but I want to just have a look at guided and have my effect selected. I have these new on-screen controls. If I move this around, let's bring my far point down here. So now we can see that everything at this level of the road and beyond is going to be counted as black. And if I bring this up actually to where it probably should be, somewhere in the sky elements over there, we return to this sort of better contrast there. If I take a look at my near point now and move this over to the pavement, to the sidewalk over on the left-hand side, this is now going to be my fixed point for whatever the front distance is going to be. So if we now render this through and take a look at what this looks like, you can see that actually we get a much more consistent looking result going through here. We don't get that same sort of strobing as we had in the trees. So whenever you want fixed points for the foreground and the background, just use guided and set those up. And if you're using the standalone version of Depth Map ML, we can always go into the mocha parameter tracking, and we have tracking elements already set up for us for the near and the far points. So we can actually track those points in. So if we want to track in like the nose on someone's face and have that as the furthest point, we could easily do that there. Let's take a look at our original shot back in After Effects again, and we'll try to manipulate the relative distances are working here. And we can do this in a couple of different ways. If we want overall changes to the brightness and contrast, well, we have these exactly in the main depth map controls, and these will add in brightness or contrast or gamma to lift the sort of middle gray areas. We want to add in a little bit more detail here. We can do that with a combination of these. Or let's just reset this. I can change the level far and the level near, which will create different black and white points for us as well. So we can see we can almost get like a transition happening directly here with these. And they are keyframeable, but I'll show you another better way of doing this in a second. If we come into our refine tools and I'll enable these, we can actually individually come in and change brightness, contrast, and gamma for the three ranges, the far, mid, and near ranges. What I think is the most interesting, though, is when we come into the matte tools. So this really defines how we start to work with these individual areas. I'll turn off my view matte mask for a second here, and I'll just invert my mask now. And by default, it's set to levels. It really means that we're working with the levels that we set with, you know, refined depth and with the level near and level far. The other thing we can do is set a threshold. Let's take a look at this as the matte mask here. So the threshold just says where we're setting our white point, and we're getting a bit of softness in there using the softness levels here. So if we wanted a smoother transition between those elements, we can do that just with softness. We also have range, where we set up a range of the areas that are going to be affected. And again, the softness is going to be the play a big part of this as well, to make sure that we can get a slightly more subtle transition between those areas. So we can easily exclude or just include one area with a range. Or my personal favorite for a lot of things is actually the slice. So this is a little bit like range, but it's actually a lot easier to work with and to animate. So we set up a center point. Turn the invert off for a second. There we go. So we set up our center point. We set up the width of that slice, and we set up the softness of the slice. And we can just move through here very, very easily. So this is great for creating transitions or for animating things on quite quickly. I do love working with slice. Here, though, I think I will just stick with the levels. Invert that. Because when we turn this off, fog and other environmental effects work quite nicely when we just have that sort of smooth fall off. It sort of feels quite natural here. We're inside of Resolve now, and I'm going to show you how we can start to use depth maps to help with color correcting and relighting. So here's the original shots. I'm just going to adjust the brightness and contrast of the pack and our cup. Here we go. I've just used a BCC plus grade here. Not doing anything clever, brightness, contrast, and gamma. But you can see it's also affecting, obviously, the background here. Now, if you wanted to just cut this out in a sort of normal, easy binary map kind of way, we wouldn't use the depth map for that. We could use something like Mocha Mask and Matte Assist and Object Brush. But here, I actually want to have a little bit more kind of fall off in the effect. And this is where depth map will really help out. So if I enable depth map there, I'll view the matte and mask there. And we can already see this is looking pretty good already. What I might do is change the mapping mode to guided, because I know that where I want my background and foreground to be. And because we're in Resolve, I'll turn on my open effects overlays, put my far distance back there somewhere, and I'll bring my nearest point, maybe somewhere at the front of the beans. Turn the matte mask off on that. Turn that on. There we go. We can start to see a big difference there. And also, if I play around with things like the gamma here to find where I want, you can see it almost starts to fall off a little bit. Because, I mean, that's exactly what we're hoping for, right? But what this means is that I can now animate these in. So if I just add in some keyframes there, and I'll come in, I'll take the brightness down quite a bit. I'll take the gamma down quite a bit as well. Contrast we'll leave up. And then if we play this through, we actually get something that looks like a light being turned up rather than just a color correction happening, because we have that sort of movement through the shot that the depth map is helping. And we can do the same sort of thing if we look at color correction as well. And this gives us an advantage over just having those sort of binary mats. I've just put on a film stocks here, turn on my depth map ML, view the matte mask. Let's invert that so only the background is being affected the most. And maybe I'll just add in a wee little bit of contrast into here. There we go, very nice. And this gives us a fall off on that sort of effect that we wouldn't be able to get if we were just sort of building this up with binary masks. And all of the features we've seen so far for depth map work the same way whether you're using it as a standalone plugin or as part of the pixel chooser. The standalone does give us a few more options when it comes to things like output. So instead of taking out black and white matte, we can have a look at the heat map, we can look at the alpha channel, or if the layer already has an alpha, we can start to work with and interact with that in a different way here with multiply screen and stencil. One of the other things that we have with the standalone is the ability, obviously, if we take it out as an alpha channel instead of a black and white matte, we can then use any other effects that work with an alpha channel to help sort of tidy things up. So if we take a look at the model comparisons of V1 faster and V1 better, and also having a look at V1 better with some edge cleaner added to it as well, there are different levels of accuracy and detail that you can get when working with Continuum Depth Map ML. I hope that's given you some good ideas about how you can start to work with Depth ML in your own projects. If you want to give a free trial a go, head over to borisfx.com and download Continuum. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris FX. I'll see you again soon.